Masada is a large mountain rock plateau that forms a stronghold in the Judean wilderness near the coastline of the Dead Sea. In Old Testament times, David hid from Saul in this area. We don't know for certain if David ever hid or stayed in Masada, but what is certain is that David saw and knew all about it. During his fugitive days from King Saul, David wrote in Psalm 18, verse 2, "The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer." Masada means fortification. And in this psalm, David used the Hebrew word that literally means Masada, providing a fitting picture of the unshakable protection and strength of God that David both trusted and believed in. God is our fortress or our fortification. And the historian Josephus writes that the site was first fortified by the Hasmoneans in the 1st century BC. Josephus further writes that Herod the Great captured Masada following the death of his father Antipater in 43 BC. Then 6 years later, according to Josephus, between 37 and 31 BC, Herod the Great built a large fortress on the plateau as a refuge for himself in the event of a revolt, and constructed two palaces with an endless supply of food and water in the event of a siege. Masada evokes emotions of yesteryear under the Roman occupation, when a group of about 900 Jews made their final stand, first in Jerusalem and then ending right here in Masada. The geography and topography of Masada are ideal for safety and protection, just as David mentions in his Psalms. It stands as a fortress against any invading army. The cliffs that surround and support this rock are steep and imposing. They're impossible for an invading army to climb without suffering huge casualties, making them perfect for a small defending force to hold out against. But for Herod the Great, it was a perfect place for another winter palace, a fortress palace, far enough away, but not too far away from Jerusalem and Caesarea. Herod the Great was a master designer and builder in his time, and he is responsible for the design and construction of some of the greatest buildings and wonders of the ancient world. And Masada is just one of them. The cliff faces all around this fortress were steep, with cliffs on the east over 400 metres high and the cliffs on the west still over 100 metres high. But Herod wanted even greater protection and presence, so he built a full perimeter, double wall around the top of the entire plateau. This wall was more than 1.4 kilometres long, with the wall 6 metres wide and 20 metres high, with 30 towers scattered along the walls every 50 metres to create the most daunting and awe-inspiring fortress man had ever seen. It must have appeared almost soul-destroying for any approaching enemy to see this impenetrable fortress rising like a phoenix out of the desert wilderness as you approach Masada from over 50 kilometres away. The most spectacular part of Masada was the northern palace complex, with its brilliant design built into the cliff face over three levels, offering 260-degree views of the Negev Desert and the Dead Sea. Its upper level comprising living areas of four grand bedrooms, all connected by a stunning staircase on the west side leading down to the middle and lower areas. The middle area was a spectacular circle reception area with rooms and a banquet hall for guests and entertainment. The lower level was a breathtaking, extravagant design with another banquet hall and a library, as well as an incredibly large Roman bathhouse, which to this day is still regarded as one of the best, if not the best, preserved Roman bathhouses in all of Israel. Most of Masada was excavated in the 1960s. And it was during this time they discovered the synagogue, where pieces of the ancient Jewish scrolls were found, including parts of the Old Testament books of Deuteronomy and Ezekiel, which foretell, ironically, of the return of Israel to the land. In AD 66, a riot broke out in the coastal port of Caesarea, which developed into an anti-tax protest against Rome. Caesarea was considered the Rome of the Middle East, and such a treasonous protest could not be tolerated. In response, the Roman procurator stormed Jerusalem with a vengeance, resulting in the deaths of more than 3,000 Jews and injuring thousands more. These were the seeds of the great Jewish revolt that would take 8 years and end in Masada in the year AD 73. The revolutionary spark had now been lit. The revolution of revolt had been ignited. The powder keg of Jewish revolt was about to explode across the land of Israel, and the whole province of Judah was on edge with rebellion and revenge. During this great revolutionary revolt, the Roman military leadership in these battles would see the rise of two future emperors, Vespasian and his son Titus. Among all the initial chaos and uncertainty, the Jewish rebels drove the Romans out of Jerusalem and captured many of the Roman garrisons around the province. One of these fortresses, was Masada. In AD 70, this great revolt brought about the siege of Jerusalem. With the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple now complete, and with the death and enslavery of thousands of Jews, so ended the organized resistance of the Jews against the Roman forces. But the fires of revolution still burned within the hearts of the diehard rebels. Refusing to become Roman slaves, they fled to Masada for one final last stand. No longer was Masada the luxurious palace that had been built and designed for. Now it was a fortress of refuge, a holdout, and the Romans were coming for them. In 73 AD, 10,000 Roman legion soldiers descended on Masada with one single purpose in mind: to extinguish the last flickering flames of the Jewish revolt. More than half of the 960 Jews on Masada were women and children. So it wasn't going to be 900 men fighting against the Roman army. It was just a handful, and it quickly became known that they would not last long. The first thing the Romans did on arriving at Masada was to set up 6 base camps around the base of the fortress. And then they constructed a 3-kilometer long, 3-meter high wall around the entire circumference of the fortress of Masada, ensuring that nobody could get in and especially nobody could get out. The siege of Masada was now well underway. However, a siege alone would not win this battle. Food and supplies for such a large Roman army could easily deplete and cause a rethink of the whole siege mentality. Plus, a conventional attack was out of the question. The undulating topography of the land around the base of Masada made it impossible to get any siege equipment or battering rams close enough to it. There was only one option left to the Romans: build a highway, build a roadway to the top of Masada. So roadwork constructions began immediately to build a highway from one side of the natural valley opposite the fortress, rising up at a 20-degree incline to the top of the walled Masada fortress. So starting 200 meters back from the valley cliff edge, The work began day after day, week after week, month after month, for about 3 months. At first, filling in a very deep valley meant progress was slow. But as the length of the road increased, the depth of the valley got shallower, each metre the road grew. So each day, the Jews woke to see the road getting closer and closer to the safety of their protective walls, until after 2 to 3 months of continuous non-stop work and with increased protection against enemy arrows, a Roman battering ram was wheeled up to the walls and a breach was finally made. And to the Roman shock, when they finally broke through and entered Masada, they were greeted by an eerie silence. Only the sound of the Roman soldiers' footsteps could be heard across the valley. The mountaintop complex had become a graveyard to the Jews, who had refused to surrender and become slave to the Romans. According to Josephus, the Jews accepted the inevitability of their fate, death or slavery. They chose death. They chose death at their own hands rather than return to slavery as their ancestors, as their great ancestors had experienced in Egypt over 3,500 years ago. The symbolism of this heroic Jewish last stand lives on today in every Jewish house in Israel and is a point of pride and parochialism for every Jewish citizen as they take pride in their Israel Defense Force training, a training that every Jewish citizen in Israel must undertake and complete, that involves at least one day at Masada where a vow or a pledge is made that Israel or Masada shall never fall to the enemy again. Today, Masada is a great Israel symbol and is revered by Zionists as an ensign that Israel or Zion shall never fall again. Amen.